What's going on, everybody? Welcome to episode 3 of the build series to build one-ton axles for a JK Wrangler. Today, we're going to be working in the shop on a high steer kit from MOTOBILT. So let me show you up our workstation and what we've set up today. What we've gone ahead and done is laid everything out, numbered in order so they're easier to find. Now, when MOTOBILT sent this to us, everything is already laser etched with a number 1 through 14. So we've laid everything out, checked our instructions so we know we've got everything in the packaging. Now, the first thing you're going to need to get before you start your build is a 7/8 drill bit. You're going to need this to be able to drill out the knuckle, and you've got to drill this out a little bit so that it will accept this large bolt. So make sure you've got your drill bit ready when you're ready to work. One thing you do need to check on before you start is you need to know what year knuckle you're going to be working on. Now, MOTOBILT set up their kit in 2 different configurations. The kit comes in the mail ready to go to work on an 09 and up knuckle, but if you have an 08 or older knuckle, then you're going to need to do a little bit of modification. How do you find out which one you have? Let me show you. Now, if you look at this knuckle, you're going to notice that here at the bottom, there is no relief cut in the bottom of this. Now, per MOTOBILT's instructions, that lets us know immediately this is an 08 or older knuckle. Now, what do we have to do to change this so that the MOTOBILT kit will work with this? Well, if you come over here to your kit, if you have an 08 or older knuckle, this means you're going to have to cut along a relief that's already placed inside this piece, and that's to make it accept and sit onto your current knuckle. That was weird. They've made this really easy already. You don't have to do any guesswork. Follow the template that they've already etched into your kit, and it'll be ready to weld in no time. Now, if you have an 09 and newer, don't worry about it. There's nothing you need to do. Everything is ready to go as it comes in the packaging. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to drill out this hole in my knuckle and expand it out to a 7/8 so that we can get that bolt through. And we're also going to do a little grinding up so we've got a clean surface to work with when we start welding. Dude, this thing is tapping inside the hole. I may set this up and go right now. Yeah, I'm not being impressed. It's going great. So now what you want to do once you've got your hole cut is you want to come back and make sure that you use some acetone and clean off all of that cutting oil, because you don't want that getting into your weld and causing porosity. Now, before we actually start doing any welding, what we're going to do now is we're going to put our bolt through and start following the instructions and laying out our pieces. And then we're going to come back with a marker and we're going to mark off everywhere that we contact the cast. We're going to take everything back off, clean it up so that we have a good weldable surface, because right now we have a lot of old rust on the outside of this knuckle, and so we need to clean every bit of this off, and then we can go back through and do our final welding. Okay, so now, like I mentioned before, since we're using an 08 and previous model Dana 60, what we're going to have to do is we're going to have to follow these little cuts on these pieces. There's 2 pieces that we're going to have to modify. They're already scribed with where we need to make our cut, but these pieces need to come off so that we can finish setting them onto our knuckles. Now, the next thing that you need to think about before you start putting your kit together is a lot of the Dana 60 knuckles are going to have this little dimple here on the front. Now, to put this kit together, this is going to be in the way of one of your plates going into its location. So what you're going to end up having to do is grind this dimple off so that your plate will drop into its proper placement. So just grab you a flap wheel and do some quick grinding. It'll be gone in no time. So now I'm going to start putting everything back on now that I've prepped my surface, shaved off the dimple that's here, got everything ready to go. Now, when I start doing my welding, what you're going to have to do is you'll notice that I'm placing each piece on one at a time, getting things lined up. And then once things are lined up, I'll place a tack weld, place another piece on. But this isn't your normal welding job where you start placing everything together and weld it all up as one unit. You do actually do need to do a little methodical thinking out ahead of time, because if you put every single piece, including the top plate, on all at once, then you're gonna have the issue where you can't weld every corner like you need to. You need to get as much weld onto this as you can to really support it. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna lay everything that I need in place one piece at a time. And once I get to certain points, you're gonna notice that I stop and I start welding it up. Now, also remember that you're working with cast steel again. So we are going to pre and post heat this to try to prevent cracking, as well as using the process called peening. Now, we're gonna knock this out and just watch how I place certain pieces together, start doing some welding, place some more pieces on, do some more welding.
All you gotta do is just tap it in. Just tap it in. Hey, just tap it in.
All right, so we're back in the shop a few months later from the last videos you just saw, and that's because we went ahead and finished up the project with those high steer kits, and then we tested it out on the trail. Now, here are the things that we want to talk about now that we've finished that project. So I'm here today with Anvil Rubicon Adventures. Anvil Jeep, right? Anvil Jeep Adventures.
Yeah. Your mom's house.
Yeah. So we're here today with Anvil Jeep Adventures. This is his Jeep, Jonathan's, and we're going to talk a little bit on the whiteboard about the things that we want you to know about the MOTOBILT high steer kit. All right, so we have actually taken the MOTOBILT high steer kit out on the trail already, tested some things out. We've done a little dialing in once we finished that project, and here are the things that I think you should know. First off, the tie rod. When you're mounting your tie rod, you only have one option, and that is the highest option. Now, other companies like Artec, they do have the option that you can mount it high or low on their high steer kit, and even on the low option is higher than normal. But with the MOTOBILT kit, you have one hole to use and one hole only. Now, is this a bad thing? Most of the time, I would say no. And in our situation here, it was not. Now, we did come across one issue with that we had to take care of, and that will bring me down to this one. All right, time out for just a second, because it just occurred to me that I should probably show you one example of why you might not want to use the MOTOBILT kit for your high steer. Now, let me show you what I'm using. So, in my situation, now you see, I'm using the Artec high steer kit. you have the option of a high and a low position for your tie rod. Now this seems like a no-brainer to instantly go for that high position to get the most clearance, but for my current situation, until I readjust my steering linkage for my drag link, I'm stuck using the low position, and here's why. Now you'll notice that my drag link is actually bolted underneath my pitman arm, and this seems all good and fine until you're at complete stuff over here, where this actually brings my tie rod right underneath where my pitman arm is at. Now, I have just enough clearance right now, just barely, that my tie rod and my drag link doesn't hang up on this tie rod. But if I move that tie rod up to the high position, I quickly figured out that my pitman arm was catching on my tie rod and binding up my steering whenever I'm full stuff on the driver's side. All I did for the time being, until I upgrade my steering and readjust some things, is I move my tie rod to the low position, which gives me enough clearance to have full lock-to-lock steering on my Jeep until I find my better option that I want to go with. But if you're using the MOTOBILT kit, you don't have that option, so keep that in mind. That may be a no-go for you. To get this to work right, we actually had to bend the tie rod a little bit to clear our differential. Now, if we had a lower option on that knuckle to choose, would that make any difference with the differential, with the diff cover? I really don't think so. With this situation, all we had to do is put a small bend on each end of our tie rod. It actually looks good. It works out perfect. Gives us plenty of clearance on our diff cover for the ram to move back and forth. So something to keep in mind, but it is not something that I would say this is a problem. You need to look out for it. Just something to keep in mind. Now, another thing we noticed about the MOTOBILT kit is that when you're looking at the top of these knuckles, you'll notice that they actually supplied some extra steel that we welded on. And this is a extra reinforcement plate you weld around the top where the bolts go through. This means it doubles the thickness in the steel where your heim joints are actually bolted to those knuckles. This, I think, is an incredible thing, and this is not something you see on the competition. That would be another great thing to think about the MOTOBILT kit versus the competition. Now, on to the next thing. We went ahead and ordered 4.5-inch backspace wheels because with a 4.5-inch backspace, that's the closest end we could really pull these wheels in and assume that we would have clearance of this high steer kit, because with high steer kits, you do get those knuckles really close to the barrel of those wheels most oftentimes. And in this case, it was extremely close. 4.5-inch backspace is the absolute minimum you can have on a wheel. And you can see from these photos that if we had any less, you would not be getting that wheel on that Jeep. So 4.5-inch backspace and up, you will need. The next thing to consider on this is that MOTOBILT actually makes a bolt hole on their knuckles that is probably a 5/8-inch bolt hole. It's a little smaller than the competition's in a lot of cases. I know with Artec, they use 3/4-inch bolts in bolt holes inside their knuckles. MOTOBILT went with a smaller diameter bolt hole. We did drill these out to a 3/4-inch because we actually had already ordered 3/4-inch heims for this kit. So we drilled those out, we went up to a larger size bolt, and it worked out great for us. That doesn't mean you have to do it, nor do I think that a smaller bolt hole would be detrimental on the trail, but it's worked out great for us, and it's something I'm not gonna complain about. So with all this being said, now I wanna get the idea of what this kit felt like on the trail. And for that, Jonathan, what are your thoughts?
What's up, guys? So, I mean, overall, I mean, for a guy that this is a very first one-ton swap, it was seamless. It went together really well. I felt like most of the material, it was very intuitive. MOTOBILT, I'll put it out there. Instructions can be a little bit better. But at the end of the day, if you are comfortable enough to do this, this is fine. If you're not comfortable enough to do this type of fabrication, that's why these videos like this are going to help out. And at the end of the day, on the trail, lock to lock, my steering was limited the first time I went out, but I was waiting on that PSC ram. We actually just threw it on there mean, I feel like this damn thing's a drift car. Like, I have so much steering angle now, whether you're mall crawling and I just got to drop my kid off into the parking lot at the daycare, or if we're out there at the trail, it's made a massive difference. And one key call out I'll have to say is that diff cover that's built into the truss. So any other kit out there, that diff cover is probably going to stick out another eighth to, you know, 3/8 of an inch. But with this one, it doesn't. It's very low profile. It gives me plenty of room for that PSC to run back and forth. I mean, everything looks like it's supposed to. So overall, very pleased with it.
He's just a spineless fanboy. No offense.
All right, guys, that's it for this episode. I hope you found it helpful. And if you did, make sure to subscribe because I have plenty more content coming out with tons of tips, tricks, off-road adventures, lots coming out. Hope you have a great day in the shop and we'll see you on the trail.